Hello everyone, once again welcome back to the course of Object Oriented Analysis and Design. This video is brought to you by Newton's Group of Institutions in association with Redefined Solutions. This is Arvind Egireddy from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, and in this video we will discuss about Advanced Behavior Modeling in UML Time and Space. So in this video we discuss about time, duration and location, modeling time constraints, modeling the distribution of objects, modeling objects that mitigate dealing with real time and distributed systems, and some common modeling techniques. We know that events may happen at unpredictable times, at demanding specific responses at specific times. A system's resource may have to be distributed around the world, and some of these resources might even more about raising issues of latency, synchronization, security and quality of service. So a distributed system is one in which the components may be physically distributed across the nodes, and these nodes may represent the different processors physically located in the same box, or they may even represent computers that are located half a world away from one another. So modeling time and space is an essential element of any real time and our distributed systems. We use a number of UML features including timing marks, time expressions, constraints and tagged values to visualize the specific construct and document these systems. So dealing with these real time and distributed systems is very hard. Good models reveal the properties of the system, time, space and characteristics. So to represent the modeling, we need real-time and distributed systems. The UML provides a graphical represented for time marks, time expressions, time constraints and locations, as we can see in this particular figure. Now coming to the terms and concepts, a timing mark is a denotation for the time at which every event occurs. So graphically, a timing mark is a dependency as a small hash mark horizontal line on the border of the sequence diagram. Now, a timing expression is an expression that evaluates to the absolute or relative value of the time. The time expression can also be formed using the name of a message and an indication of the stage in its processing. For example, request.sendTime or request.receiveTime. So here, a timing constraint is a semantic statement about the relative or absolute value of the time. And graphically, a timing constraint is rendered as per any constraint that is a string enclosed by brackets and generally connected to the elements of dependency relationship. And location is the placement of the components on a node, and location is an attribute of an object. Coming to time, real-time systems are by their very name time critical systems, and events may happen at regular or irregular times. So the response to an event must happen at a predictable absolute time or a predictable time relative to and to the event itself. The passing of message represents the dynamic aspects of any system. So when we model the time critical nature of a system with the UML, we can give a name to each message in an interaction to be used in time expressions. So messages in an interaction are usually not given names. They are mainly rendered with the name of an event. such as a signal or a call. However, we can give them names to write the time expressions, because the same event may be triggered in different messages. If the designated messages is ambiguous, we use the explicit name of the message in an expression to designate the message we want to mention at the time expression. Now, given a message name, we can refer any of the three functions of the message, that is send time, receive time, and transmission time. So these are our suggested functions, not official to the UML functions. So here a real-time system might have even more functions. For synchronous calls, we can also refer to the round-trip message times with execution time, and we can use them, or we can use these functions to specify the arbitrarily complex time expressions, perhaps even using weights or offsets that are either constants or variables, as long as these are those variables can be bound to an execution time. So finally, as shown in this figure, we can place these time expressions in the time constraints to specify the timing behavior of the system. As constraints, we can render them by placing them adjacent to the appropriate message, or we can explicitly attach them using the dependency relationship. Coming to locations, distributed systems by their nature encompasses components that are physically scattered among the nodes of the system. For many systems, components are fixed in place at the time they are loaded onto the system. So in other systems, these components might migrate from node to node. So in the UML, we model the development view of the system by using development diagram that represents the topology of the process and devices on which our system executes. So artifacts such as executable libraries and tables reside on these nodes, and each instance of a node will have its own instances of certain artifacts, and each instances of an artifact will be owned by exactly one instance of a node. Although these instances of the same kind of artifacts may be spread across the different nodes. So here, components and classes may be manifested as artifacts. For example, here as in this figure shows, class load agent is manifested by the artifact initializer.exe that lives on the node of the type router. So as the figure illustrates, we can model the location of the artifact in two ways in the UML. First, as shown for the router, we can physically nest the elements, that is a textual or graphically, in an extra compartment in its enclosure nodes. And second, we can use a dependency with the keyword deploy for an artifact to the node that contains it. Now coming to some common modeling techniques, modeling timing constraints. So here, modeling the absolute time of an event and modeling the relative time between the events are the primary time critical properties of the real-time system for which we will use timing constraints. So to model the timing constraints for each event in an interaction, we need to consider whether it must start at some absolute time, and then we need to model that real-time property as a timing constraint on the message. And for each interesting sequence of a message in an interaction, we need to consider whether there is an association maximum relative time for that particular sequence. And model that real-time property as a timing constraint on the sequence. For example, as shown in this figure, the leftmost constraints specify the repeating start time for the call event refresh. So here, Similarly, the write time constraint which specifies the maximum duration for the call to get the image, that is get image. So in this figure, modeling timing constraints, often we will choose short names for the messages so that we don't confuse them with the operation names. Now, modeling the distribution of an object. So here, when we model the topology of a distributed systems, we must have to consider the physical placements of both nodes and artifacts. If we focus in the configuration management of the deployed system, then modeling the distribution of the nodes is especially important in order to visualize, specify, construct, and document the placements of the physical things such as executables, libraries, and tables. So in our focus, the main goal or the main functionality, scalability, or throughput of the system modeling the distribution of the object is what is most important. So here, deciding how to distribute the objects in a system is a difficult problem, and not just because these problems of the distributed or the these problems in the distribution interact with the problems of the concurrency. So Navi solutions tends to yield profoundly poor performance, and our engineering solutions are not much better. So in fact, they are probably worse because they usually end up being brittle. So here, to model the distribution of objects for each interesting class of an object in our system, we need to consider its locality of reference. So in other words, we need to consider all its neighbors and their locations. Here, the tightly coupled locality will have neighbor objects close by, and a loosely coupled one will have distant objects, and thus there will be latency in communicating with them. Tentatively, we need to allocate these objects closest to the actors that manipulate them. Next, we need to consider patterns of interaction among these related set of objects, co-locate set of these objects that have higher degree of interactions to reduce the cost of communication. Next, we need to partition the set of objects that have low degree of interaction. Next, we need to consider the distribution of responsibilities across the system and redistribute our objects to balance the load of each node. And here, we also need to consider the issues of security, volatility, and quality of service, and redistribute our objects as appropriate. Now, coming to assigning objects to the artifacts so that the tightly coupled objects are on the same artifact. So here, assigning artifacts to nodes so that the computation needs of each node are within the capacity, and add additional nodes if necessary. So here, balance performance and communication cost by assigning tightly coupled artifacts to the same node. Here, this figure provides an object diagram that models the distribution of certain objects in a retail system. The value of this diagram is that it lets us visualize the physical distribution of certain key objects. As the diagram shows, two objects resides on a workstation, the order and sales objects, and two objects resides on the server, that is the observer agent and the product objects. And one object resides on the data warehouse, the product table object. Thank you all. If you like this video, please subscribe to my channel and press the bell icon for the latest notifications. Thank you all.